The United Kingdom, land of drizzle, double-decker buses, and maybe, just maybe, a clean energy overachiever. Back in Australia, we've got better weather, better beaches, better beer, better local cuisine, and of course, we're better at cricket, which I don't care about personally, but I have learned that Brits do care, even the ones who say they don't, and it's fun to tease. But in the race to decarbonise the electricity grid, could the UK actually win something for a change? Because this autumn, for the first time ever, the United Kingdom is expecting to run entirely on zero emissions electricity for a few hours. That doesn't just mean a sunny day with loads of solar and wind and some exports to neighbours. That's happened before. But even during those times, gas power was still online, helping to keep the grid stable. This time, the goal is no gas, no coal, no oil, and no electricity imports. Just clean, homegrown electricity. It's a big milestone and a taste of what a fully zero emissions grid could look like. 40 years ago, coal made up 3/4 of the UK's electricity. Even 15 years ago, it was still mostly fossil fueled, but with gas instead of coal. So how did they get from that to here? And what would it take to go from a few hours of clean electricity to 24/7, 365? And beyond electricity, what else needs to happen to get to a fully zero emissions energy system? And to help me understand how this works, I've brought in everybody's favorite British YouTuber, David Boulez from Just Have a Think.
Yeah, hi Rosie. Well, welcome to the UK. I liked your intro. We might not win the Ashes, but we might beat you to net zero. And I'm sorry we couldn't meet in a walkabout pub. It's where you Aussies usually end up working. But I thought a nice garden in the middle of London might show off some of England's treasures.
I'm willing to keep an open mind, and I have bought you some Australian treasures, some Vegemite, some proper Freddo frogs, and some Tim Tams, willing to exchange for your energy insight.
Okay, sounds like a reasonable deal.
I'm Rosie Barnes, founder of Paddle Oak Consulting, where we advise on clean energy technologies, helping startups with development and investors with assessing the landscape. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. And by the way, make sure to watch all the way to the end of the video. We're settling the age-old question, Tim Tam versus Penguin. Biscuit supremacy will be decided. The UK has been aggressively phasing out coal since the 1990s, and finally last year in September 2024, the last one closed for good. That's a massive shift, considering that coal was traditionally the backbone of the UK's electricity system, enabling the Industrial Revolution, etc. Even though getting rid of coal is a win for the climate, I'm not sure that the UK deserved too many brownie points for it. The reason for the move away from coal was primarily because they were running out of coal, not because of climate concern. And at that time, they didn't shift to nuclear or renewables, they mostly just shifted to gas, which they happened to have plenty of.
All gas started in the 1970s with the oil crisis, and we had the chance to go to wind turbines like Denmark did, but obviously we had North Sea oil and gas that was just being discovered at the time, and that's really something that the UK government thought was a bit of a goldmine, which of course it turned out to be. And then in the 1980s, Margaret Thatcher saw the writing on the wall for the coal industry, because as you say, we were running out of coal, and we needed to replace it with something quickly and easily, and gas was the obvious choice.
So even if it wasn't primarily a climate-caused transition, it did lead to a significant drop in carbon emissions. In fact, per capita emissions in the UK are now lower than they've ever been. The UK has managed to cut its emissions in half since 1990 while maintaining economic growth and increasing standard of living.
Yeah, that's all true, Rosie. I would just offer one caveat about the emissions per capita and what they call the territorial emissions versus global emissions. While we did do a good job of reducing our coal consumption, a lot of that was also due to the fact that we changed our economy from an industrialised economy to a services-based economy. And that meant that a lot of that industry that made all the stuff that we bought got offshored, mostly to China, of course, which is where their carbon emissions went up as they became the factory of the world, if you like. So the government would say, you know, we've reduced it 40% since 1990. It's probably significantly less than that if you counted in shipping and aviation and offshoring. It's not all rosy in the garden, so to speak.
I think that you're employing a little bit of a characteristic British excessive modesty. Yes, that is true, but it accounts for less than half of the drop in emissions. And a 27% drop in consumption-based emissions since 1990s. And the UK is on par with the best performance of the G7, only slightly behind Italy at 28% and Germany at 30%. One of the biggest drivers of this transition has been government policy. I recently made a video about China's energy transition, and in that video I called out its planned nature as something that sets it apart from Western countries, who endlessly endlessly squabble over the politics of climate change, rendering us incapable of making and executing a plan. But somehow, despite not being immune from the kind of political squabbles that we've had, the UK has managed to make a decarbonisation plan and stick with it. How on earth have you done this? I genuinely don't understand.
So fundamentally, it was written into law very early on, 2008, probably before anybody else in the developed world. And there was an independent body that kept an eye on the progress of each government.
In the 12 months to today, wind has overtaken gas for the first time to become the UK's biggest source of electricity, generating 30% of the total. Gas provided 29%, followed by nuclear at 15%, biomass at 7%, and solar at 5%. And about 12% of the UK's electricity came through interconnectors from neighbouring countries. So wind has done the heavy lifting here, and particularly offshore wind. And to be honest, that is something that I never predicted a decade ago, when offshore wind seemed to me just a very expensive and complicated activity to give offshore oil and gas companies something green sounding to mess with. So if you compare the story to Australia, where we haven't even got any offshore wind projects under construction yet, or to the US, where the sector has gone from bold ambition to backpedaling, the UK actually looks like an overachiever. The US set a target of 30 gigawatts of offshore wind by 2030, but as of now, early 2025, they've got barely 100 megawatts actually operating. Several major projects have been cancelled or delayed in the last year due to rising costs, supply chain issues, and shaky policy support. There is no way they're coming anywhere near close to their 2030 target, given the current political climate. Meanwhile, the UK has not only put turbines in the water, they've built the biggest offshore wind farms in the world.
Offshore and onshore were kind of bumbling along together for a while, and then in 2015, David Cameron's government effectively banned onshore wind by making it so difficult to get planning permission, etc., that it was effectively a non-starter. So offshore was the obvious choice. We got Hornsea 2, already the biggest standalone wind farm in the world. Dogger Bank comes online, it'll be even bigger than Hornsea 2. We're about 15 gigawatts already. We're hoping to be 50 gigawatts by 2030, and maybe 95 gigawatts by 2050.
All right, so yes, you're winning in offshore wind, but let's see how you go with Vegemite.
Vegemite, eh? Now, just for absolute disclosure, I'm a vegan, so I eat Marmite a lot, so I'm going to be interested to see how this compares.
Oh my God, it's runny.
Look at Rome. See, I want to say that's really horrible, but actually it's quite nice.
Is it?
Yeah, I think I'm going to stick with Marmite. It was nearly there, Rosie, it was so close.
But right, that's concentrated excellence. You're just not ready. Anyway, let's move on to solar. You've not reached the levels of rooftop solar that we have in Australia. That is something that we are world leading in. But for a country known for being overcast, ironically, not today on the day that we've chosen to film this video, but you do have a not insignificant amount of solar in your grid for a country that is, yeah, generally known for being very overcast. How have you managed that?
Rooftop solar certainly has sort of captured the imagination of a lot of people in the UK. Like you say, we've got a sunny day today. They're not that unusual even in this country, and even further north in Europe as well. So the installation of solar systems on a rooftop is probably half what it was 8 years ago. And you're competing, you're replacing electrons that used to cost twice as much 8 years ago. All of a sudden, the payback time is significantly lower. So even in this country, the average consumer is realising that after insulation, which of course is the most obvious thing here, and solar panels are by far the easiest and quickest way to reduce your energy bills and do something for the climate.
And to round out today's clean electricity mix, existing nuclear built in the 80s and 90s is still chugging along, plus small amounts of run-of-river hydro, bioenergy, and pumped hydro. The main mechanism that's allowed such rapid installation of renewable energy generation has been the government's Contracts for Difference, or CFD scheme. It guarantees a fixed price for electricity from new projects. If the market price is lower, then the government tops it up. And if it's higher, then the generators pay the difference back. So during the recent energy crisis, CFD projects were actually returning money to consumers. This year, 9 offshore wind projects were awarded, totaling 5 gigawatts. And one thing that stood out to me is how cheap offshore wind is here. In the awarded projects, they were just £54 to £59 per megawatt hour, which is not that much more than the £51 awarded for the 1 gigawatt of onshore wind. Contracts were also awarded to 3 gigawatts of solar, and also the world's largest floating offshore wind project at 400 megawatts, and 6 tidal power projects totaling 28 megawatts. I'll be covering tidal power in a separate video during this trip. All of these changes have put a whole lot more renewables in the grid. We're recording this on a sunny spring day, and over the weekend, there was a short time when clean energy sources made up 90% of the total. However, getting all the way to 100% involves much more than merely finding an extra 10% of clean generation. The electricity grid itself is going to need some work. Getting to a grid that can run entirely on renewables, even for a few hours, is no small feat. The electricity grid was designed around thermal generators like coal, gas, and nuclear. Not only are those sources mostly constant through the day and night and through the seasons, they are big, heavy, rotating equipment with a lot of physical inertia. That means that when there is a sudden disturbance, like a power line blown over or a thermal generator unexpectedly trips, the grid voltage and frequency stay pretty stable because the big spinning masses just keep spinning. They simply physically cannot slow down or speed up suddenly. Wind and solar, on the other hand, don't contribute to that inertia. So if the grid were to try today to run purely or even mostly off these sources, it would not be resilient. Right now, the UK is limited in how much inverter-based renewable technology it can integrate at once. The previous cap has been 75% due to the need for some amount of traditional power sources to maintain grid stability. Overcoming this limitation on inverter-based generation is key to running on renewables for longer periods. Nuclear sits nice and constant, just under 4 gigawatts most of the time, around 10 to 15% of generation, and it's got nice big heavy rotating mass, but the rest has to come from somewhere else. So the UK is installing grid-forming batteries, synchronous condensers, and working on monitoring grid stability better.
Yeah, so part of that take-up of that slack is probably going to be batteries. Part of it's going to be interconnectors. We've already got interconnectors with Europe, so that, you know, we've got in Norway, they've got a lot of hydro, so we pull electrons from them when we need them, and we give some back when they need them. Batteries, we're at about 5 gigawatts, I think, capacity of batteries right now, and that's going to go up a lot in the coming years, probably more like 22 gigawatts by 2030.
Another clever tool in play is a 5 megawatt ultracapacitor acting like grid sonar. It sends pulses of energy through the system and sensors around the grid measure its response. That lets operators assess how stable the grid is in real time and get early warning of trouble brewing, especially when the grid's running on lots of wind and solar with minimal traditional backup. When the UK hits 100% clean electricity, even just for a few hours, the real headline isn't going to be the emissions saved. It's that the grid can stay stable without leaning on big old thermal plants. Honestly, that's a bigger deal than the emissions numbers themselves. Managing a grid with no coal, no gas, and just a little bit of nuclear inertia is hard. If the UK can pull it off, even briefly, it proves that running a modern grid on variable renewables isn't just theory, it works. And it sets the stage for clean electricity to become the norm, not the exception. But a few hours of clean energy is obviously still a long way from the goal of net zero across the entire energy system. What will it take to get there? 2030, the plan is to roughly triple today's offshore wind and solar, double onshore wind, and nuclear and gas to remain constant. To support the variable energy sources, long-duration energy storage needs to increase by about 2 times, batteries by about 5 times, and consumer-led flexibility, aka demand response, by 4 times. And that's all just in the next 5 years. By 2030, their plan is to produce more clean energy over the year than they consume, and 95% of their generation will be clean, with fossil gas making up the remaining 5% of generation. However, that's truly the easy part. It's just doing a lot more of the same kind of things that they're already doing. The harder part is going to be not just getting enough generation and storage, it'll be making sure that the clean electricity is available where people actually want to use it.
And this, Rosie, is where my mate Greg Jackson comes into the fray. He's the chief executive of Octopus Energy, which is now the largest energy provider in the UK. And he is a big exponent of zonal pricing. The basic point is, if you have got all these wind turbines in Scotland, they are blowing all the time. And because we don't have yet the infrastructure to pipe all those electrons down south when they're needed all the time, we spend a lot of time curtailing or just switching off those wind turbines and paying the wind turbine operators millions of pounds to not work. It's absolutely bonkers. But what if we gave the people that live near those turbines cheaper electricity? That would obviously benefit the people of Scotland, but it might actually change the behaviour of businesses as well, which predominantly bury themselves around the M25 corridor, in other words, around London. If we can persuade some of them to go up north where the electrons are being generated, they're going to get much cheaper electricity. And so we're driving the right behaviours, and then we start redistributing the demand around the country where the supply is being generated, rather than supplying in wherever we can find it and then finding some complicated way of piping it into a completely different part of the country. And that's Greg Jackson's argument. Zonal pricing is complicated. It means there's going to be lots of different prices for lots of different parts of the country. His view is that it will drive prices down everywhere, but it needs to be managed by a very sophisticated piece of software, which he just happens to have created in Kraken.
Currently, the plan is that hydrogen will start to replace that last bit of gas after 2030, or carbon capture and storage. I have feelings about hydrogen or CCS playing a significant role in electricity generation, but I don't want to trash a plan for a country I've been in for all of 48 hours, actually not even. So Dave, why don't you do that?
Well, okay. I have feelings about hydrogen and CCS as well, and I've expressed those feelings on more than one occasion on the videos on my channel. Hydrogen, it's got some uses, but they're very limited. It certainly isn't going to be used, it shouldn't be used as a fuel. CCS is completely unproven at scale. Where it is used, 70% of it is used to liberate oil from depleted oil seams in enhanced oil recovery, they call it euphemistically.
So to recap, the plan in 2030 is to keep some gas in the system, which I know some people will see it as a bit weak, but truthfully, if this is half-assing it, it is half-assing I can get behind. It makes so much sense to do the easy part really quickly. Leave some of the existing gas infrastructure there as a pretty cheap form of Dunkelflaute insurance and not spend the ridiculous amount of money, time, effort to try and make dumb solutions, Dave's words, not mine, like hydrogen and CCS on power plants work. Better to spend that effort on the many remaining larger emissions challenges like transport and heating. Electric vehicles are a major part of the plan, with a goal of 80% of cars being electric by 2040 and all new cars being zero emissions by 2035. But electrifying transport isn't just about cars, it's also about trucks, buses, and even ships and planes. Electrification of heavy transport is a bigger challenge, and one I'm about to film a full video on that topic with Cambridge Professor David Seaborn later today, actually, so watch out for that one soon. This shift will put additional pressure on the electricity grid, making the need for clean, reliable power supply even greater.
You're right. Electric vehicles will play a massive part of our transition. We've chosen not to put tariffs on UK imports of electric vehicles in the way that the European Union have. And in this one instance, that's helpful because it means the UK EV market is growing quickly. Once we've got 20 million of them on the roads, basically batteries with a wheel at each corner, they will be an enormous part of grid stability.
Another challenge is home heating. The UK has an enormous number of older homes that were built before energy efficiency was such a consideration. Gas boilers are still the standard for heating, but they need to be replaced with heat pumps and other low carbon options. Retrofitting homes to be more energy efficient is going to be a major undertaking for the UK. So what are the houses like here? I know a lot of Brits complain about how poor the housing stock is here, but let's be honest, Brits do like to complain.
On this occasion, they've got some validity. We have got the oldest and leakiest housing stock in Europe. If we could just insulate our homes so that we weren't losing heat in the first place. Most of the heat pumps we're selling are air to water, and with the modern efficient gases, it just works a treat.
So that's mostly a lot of good news, really, which is far too optimistic for a couple of negative Nancys like me and especially Dave. So let's talk about some of the harder parts, like new nuclear builds are not going that well.
But the bottom line with nuclear power is it's extremely expensive and it overruns. Current Hinkley Point C, I think it was originally budgeted for £18 billion. Looking like it's going to be more like £40 or £50 billion now, and it's overrun by about 10 years. They're just complicated to build because the regulations are really, really difficult to comply with. We haven't got that amount of time. We're talking about changing things in the next 10 years maximum. You're not going to get nuclear to be predominantly your power source in 10 years.
Why is the government committing itself to expensive technologies like floating offshore wind and tidal power when there are cheaper proven alternatives available?
There is a concern that we're sort of grasping at every opportunity that comes our way, when actually we should be saying, we know offshore wind works, we know onshore wind works, we know solar works and battery energy storage works, interconnectors work, and if we can start building in some geographical energy differences as well, so that we drive the right behaviours in where people go to be near to where the electrons are being generated. That's probably 90% of what we really need to do, and the rest is just frippery.
Do Brits really want more onshore wind?
Most Brits, I think, are pretty ambivalent, if not actually fairly positive about onshore wind turbines. I think most people don't see them as ugly. And if you're going to get a better deal, if you're going to get a reduced rate where they build onshore wind turbines, most people are going to be for that.
So that's the UK's energy transition, past, present, and what's coming next. There's still plenty of challenges ahead, especially in like transport and home heating, but in electricity, they're leading the pack. And I have to admit, maybe, just maybe, the UK has finally found something that it's better at than Australia. We'll take the cricket and you can have offshore wind. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team for their support, and you can join us at this link. Also, thanks to the ERA Foundation and their Born to Engineer grant, which allowed me to stay a few days in the UK while I was working in Europe. And of course, biggest thanks to Dave for joining me on this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Okay, most important part of the video, Australia versus the UK. Tim Tams, the world's
best.
Oh my God. See how they're...
Wow. Come on, you know you want to.
What's this? Why is everything wet?
No, come on, it's melted.
It's not as bad as I thought, actually.
Oh, thanks.